Teacher said we could have a little show and tell right now, and so I'm going to do that with your permission. Remember show and tell next to recess, our most favorite time in school? When you got your 3 minutes of glory to stand in front of your little buddies and girls and tell them something you made or did or went somewhere you went. And I have two items I want to share with you. In my hands from the reputable news organization ChristianScienceMonitor.com. I'm going to read this to you. Little show and tell item. Headline, for real education reform, take a cue from the Adventists. This is a very respected news organization. Interesting. How's it go? Amid all the buzz on education reform, the Seventh-day Adventist school system might seem an unexpected place to look for models in improving student achievement, but by educating mind, body, and spirit, Adventist schools outperform the national average across all demographics. Amazing. Amazing. And I understand that you have a few of those schools right here in the great state of Oregon. Thank God for our teachers, who at the salaries they receive turn out numbers like this. We lead the nation. Some people say, well, you know, the problem is you're a private school system. And so you get the creme de la creme and people who can afford it and... Nope, they've done studies of Adventist schools, and they find out we, of all school systems, most approximate the public school system in terms of socioeconomic demographics. Something's happening in education. Well, if we had more time, I'd read more from that. Next, I go to another very respected national news journal, and if that camera's the one with the red, I wish you'd pull in on this, please. Yeah, there you go. You recognize this magazine here? Don't worry about the color. I sat out there this morning and I realized what you've been looking at all week. My apologies. I didn't know I looked so sick. All right. Can you tell what magazine this is? This is National Geographic magazine. All right, let me just read that. This is cover story, The Secrets of Living Longer. Whoa, that has me interested. If you're getting up in years, you would... be interested, I suppose. How can I live a little bit longer? And so I go to the cover story. Here's the beginning. What if, the author here, what if I said you could add up to 10 years to your life? A long, healthy life is no accident. It begins with good genes, but it also depends on good habits. If you adopt the right lifestyle, experts say, Karen told me, by the way, last night, she says, you know what, Dwight, you read so fast. You've got a Russian translator over there who can't follow a bloomin' thing. And so my apologies to that voice behind the wall there. I know I'm reading way too fast. I get that complaint at Pioneer all the time. It's so nice not to be home and hear it from the same people. So what's the formula for success? In recent years, researchers have fanned out across the globe to find out the secrets to long life. Funded in part by the U.S. National Institute on Aging, scientists have focused on several regions, one of which is Loma Linda, California, where researchers studied a group of Seventh-day Adventists who rank among America's longevity all-stars. Whoa, let me get to that part about Loma Linda. Where is that? Oh, here it is. The Adventist Church, born during the era of the 19th century health reforms that popularized organized vegetarianism, the graham cracker and breakfast cereals, in parentheses, John Harvey Kellogg was an Adventist when he started making wheat flakes, the Adventist Church has always preached and practiced a message of health. It expressly forbids smoking, alcohol consumption, and eating biblically unclean foods such as pork. It also discourages the consumption of other meat, rich foods, caffeinated drinks. Really? I didn't know that was in there. All right, rich foods, caffeinated drinks, and stimulating condiments and spices. Now here's a quotation. Grains, fruits, nuts, and vegetables constitute the diet chosen for us by our Creator, wrote Ellen White, an early figure who helped shape the Adventist Church. Adventists also observe the Sabbath on Sunday, socializing as we did today gloriously with other church members and enjoying a sanctuary and time that helps relieve stress. Today, most Adventists follow the prescribed lifestyle, a testimony perhaps to the power of mixing health and religion. Wow. two show-and-tell headlines tonight. And what do both headlines have in common? 5 feet, 2 inches. Both of them are the result of a ministry of a little woman. 5 feet, 2 inches, who, according to the word on the street overheard, is borrowed everything she wrote, plagiarized it all. Well, if she plagiarized it all, how come nobody else is living 10 years longer? If what she had was there for everybody else would be living 10 years longer, wouldn't they? Two Australian physicians. No. One is Australian, ENT, ear, nose, throat specialist Don McMahon, and Loma Linda University biologist and researcher Leonard Brand collaborated to find the answer. Okay, this is the health question now. Let me put it on the screen for you here. Do you see it on the screen? Yeah, Leonard Brand and Don McMahon. He's the Australian. Leonard Brand is a researcher down at Loma Linda. The critics claims that Ellen White's writings can be explained as originating from strictly human sources do not stand up to critical evaluation. Dr. Don McMahon's research reveals a dramatic difference in quality between Mrs. White's health principles and those advocated by other health reformers in the 1800s. Do you know what health reformers in the 1800s were advocating? I hadn't known that either until I got their book, these two scientists. This Sylvester Graham, who came up with Graham crackers, you know Graham crackers. Here are some of his avocations. Don't heat your house. Go naked. Don't rock a baby to sleep. Don't drink water. Get your liquids only from fruit. Prevailing. Here's from William Alcott. Wear very little clothing, even when it's cold. Don't use eyeglasses. Don't comfort children. Crying is good for them. I love this one. Avoid sweating in hot weather. What are you supposed to do? Now, in Oregon, you don't have to worry in the summer because you're so cold around here. I've never seen a state like yours. Anyway, avoid excessive spitting. Don't nurse babies at night, like when you're supposed to feed them. Don't wear black. Okay. All right, the point is, somebody was coaching the little woman to know what to take and what to leave aside, leading these two brilliant scientists to conclude, may I put his words, put their words on the screen, this difference, what we've just read, indicates that Mrs. White had health information that could not have come from any human source available anywhere at the time she lived and wrote. So where did it come from? Well, at least in those areas of health, our research has provided evidence, okay? In the areas of health, our research has provided evidence that demands an extra-biblical, that means outside of the Bible, extra-human, outside of human source of information to account for the accuracy of her health principles, end quote. Thank you, National Geographic, for your kind words. We know where the source came from. Source came from God himself. Let me share this with you. Exodus 15, 26. God said to the children of Israel, the chosen ones, as they were leaving on this journey to the promised land, if you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. I am your creator, and I wrote the owner's manual. Follow the owner's manual, and you'll have a 10-year edge on the rest of society. Isn't that amazing? A 10-year edge. So what are we going to do with this gift, this testimony of Jesus? I want you to open your Bible, please, also to the apocalypse. I'm going to go back just for a moment to that chapter 12. And then I want to make an invitation for you to add to your library, okay? Revelation chapter 12. I'm gonna do this fast. So let's just keep the screen on. I think we'll be okay. Revelation 12, verse 1. This is the great history of the Christian movement from Calvary, from the birth of Jesus, actually, to the end. actually has a little insertion to talk about the rebellion that began in heaven with the fallen Lucifer. It's all contained in this dynamite, aggressive, in-your-face apocalyptic revelation. All right, so let's read Revelation 12, verse 1. Now a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. I love this picture of the woman. You know, she's a pure woman. Remember, a woman represents the community of faith. Pure woman would represent God's raised up community of faith. She has a garland that's a Stephanos, Stephanie or Stephen. It's the garland of victory, Olympics, the garland of victory that you wear when you win. She's a winner. Stick with that woman. She's a winner. She's a winner. Stay with the woman. Some of you have been along the way. I just heard the testimony that you heard. I walked away. I walked away. I walked away. But Jesus brought me back. Stay with the woman. It's her. It's his woman. Stay with the woman. All right, so it goes on. Then being with child, so she's pregnant, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth, and another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems, diademata. Okay, so this is now the crown of a conqueror, not a victor. No, he's no victor, but he's a conqueror. He's a ruler, aggressive, killer. 7 crowns on his 7 heads, 7 diadems. Now, I went to Google. I said, find me the ugliest dragon you can find, and that's what Google found for me. Isn't that something? That's one of the 7 heads. Wow, that's the dragon. And what's the big deal about the dragon and the woman? Keep reading. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven. Lucifer took a third of the... You know, I have moms and dads come to me, and they say, I've been such a failure. Remember, the perfect parent in the universe, the most perfect parent, lost a third of his family. You can love perfectly and still have your children run away from home. Quit kicking yourself around the block, Papa and Mama. Just use your knees and pray, as somebody just mentioned in his testimony. Just keep praying for those children. He drew a third of the father's family, threw them to the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth, salivating. The dragon was to devour her child, capital C, as soon as that boy was born in Bethlehem. And the dragon was there, and we all know the Christmas story. She bore a male child who was to rule all nations, messianic nomenclature, with a rod of iron, and her child caught up to heaven, missed him. And because he missed the child, was defeated at Calvary, guess whom the dragon turns upon? Yeah, the woman. You got it. Verse 6, and the woman fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there. This 1,260-year dark and Middle Ages period. The church goes underground. Keep your eye on that woman. Stay with the woman. Now when the dragon saw, verse 13, that he had been cast to the earth, he persecuted the woman. He's after the woman. Perhaps even literally after the woman. Get that woman out of here. He persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child, and the dragon was enraged. Here comes a familiar text. He was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring who keep the commandments of God and who have the testimony of Jesus Christ. The gift. The gift is the gift of Jesus. Whatever this end-time community is, just before Jesus returns, they will not only be Sabbatarian commandment keepers, they will have the gift. And what is the gift? What is that testimony of Jesus? Revelation 19:10, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. They will have the presence of a prophet in their midst, the gift, just before the end of time. Jesus said, by their fruits you'll know them. The only way I can figure out these two headlines, something good is going on with that gift. You don't think the devil wrote those headlines, do you? Please. The dragon would never have those headlines. He would crush them if he could. Too late. Too late. All right. So what's the big deal? Here's the deal. Why is the dragon so furious with this woman? This community of faith, and in particular, this testimony of Jesus. Why is the dragon furious with the testimony of Jesus? This is a no-brainer. This isn't even rocket science. Why would he be furious? Because it's all about Jesus, that's why. And Lucifer has had a jaded, evil eye against Christ from the get-go, has he not? Of course he turns on the testimony of Jesus. You know why he turns on the testimony of Jesus? Because the gift of prophecy, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19, the gift of prophecy is like a massive halogen light. Do you ever go driving down the interstate in the middle of the night? You're racing home, and you're in unfamiliar country, but all of a sudden you see this shoo, shoo, in the dark. You see this big streak of light, right? Shoo. What do you know when you're near one of those? A used car sale. No, generally, what is it? It's an airport. That massive halogen lamp shines into the darkness. When I go running in the winter in Michigan, trust me, it's cold and it's dark at 6:30. I take this little tiny halogen lamp. Why do I want the halogen lamp? Because I need the ground between me and the unknown future illuminated so that I do not step into trouble while I'm running. I need to see what is just ahead of me. That's why they give you these lamps. But the lamp is useless if you leave it on your bookshelf and let it gather dust there. You have to take it off the bookshelf and actually turn it on and let it shine for you. That's the whole point of having an LED, white, blue light to shine in the dark. If I were the devil and there were this massive light penetrating into the inky darkness of my lair where I hide, and that light is shining in my eyes, if I were the devil with all seven heads, and it's all apocalyptic imagery, I'd come out with all seven heads, and I would go for that light and kill it. I would kill the light. And if I could not kill the light, I would find a way to blow it to smithereens. If I were the devil, that's what I'd do. Wouldn't you? If that massive light is penetrating your dark, evil mastermind endgame, you would seek to snuff the light out. Would you not? Of course you would. He's furious, which is why he's adopted two diabolical strategies against the gift, the testimony of Jesus, 5 feet 2 inches. Diabolical strategy number one. Let's see if it's the next slide. Yep, there it is. Strategy number one, if I were the devil, if I were the dragon, I would ravage the author and her writing so that no one will read her. I would raise up every critic I could find in an effort to destroy the credibility of that gift. I would destroy her influence. I would cast doubt on her integrity. I would accuse her of the basest of motives that I could possibly concoct. I would raise up every website in the world, if I could, to destroy that blinding halogen light that exposes my endgame to the human race. That's what I'd do. I'd either, strategy number one, ravage the author and her writing so that no one will read her, or equal and opposite but brilliant strategy, strategy number two, I would overemphasize the author and her writings so that no one will ever read her. I'd raise up congregations that would use her like a baseball bat to whack the young into conformity. That's what I would do. I would raise whole pockets of extremism. I would raise those pockets and I would make them all high advocates of the spirit of prophecy. I would raise those pockets up because the very nature of those pockets makes people say, if that's what they are like, I'll never go to what they quote. That's what I'd do. Brilliant. He wins either way. Either way, he wins. He is no dummy. He's the highest created intelligence in the universe. He was. Which is why I'm very grateful for the bright mind of the scholar who happens to be the namesake of the university where I pastor, John Nevins Andrews. I thought this was insightful. Let me just run this by you, and then we'll move to conclusion. He wrote about the gift of prophecy in the End Time Community of Faith on February 15, 1870, in an issue of the Review and Herald. He laid out 20 short points. I'm not going to share the 20 points with you, but I was particularly intrigued by the last two points. If you have the study guide, you'll have all this. But I was intrigued by the last two points. Let me put them up here. Number 19, one of the chief gifts of the Spirit of God that he has placed in the New Testament church is the gift of prophecy. And there are all the references. This gift, the Bible connects with the closing work of this dispensation. Spiritual gifts do not therefore cease to be of importance in the sight of God, nor in that to his true people. Oh, spiritual gifts go all the way to the end. Contrary to what some say, oh, it all ended with the New Testament. Not on your life. And that message, which is to accomplish the perfecting of the saints and to fit them for translation, that's the whole point, to get ready for the midnight arrival of Christ. That message that has the Spirit of God connected with it and speaking out in the management of its work, that is the gift at the end of time. Now, number 20, extremely well-balanced, and I have to share this with you. Finally, he says, in summation, in the reception of members into our churches, all right, so we're welcoming new people who keep joining us around the world. They join us in Michigan, in Oregon, on every continent of earth. This little Protestant denomination, because of this 5'2" woman, is in more nations than any other denomination on earth. Protestant. Yeah, I mean, please. So finally, in the reception of new members into our churches, we desire on this subject to know two things. Isn't this good? Number one, we want the new members to believe the Bible doctrine of spiritual gifts. Please see that the Bible teaches that. And then only number two, that they will candidly acquaint themselves with the visions of Ellen White, which have ever held so prominent place in this work. We believe that every person standing thus and carrying out this purpose will be guided in the way of truth and righteousness, and these are my italics, and these who occupy this ground, I'm just checking her out right now, are never denied all the time they desire to decide this matter. Isn't that balanced? You can have all the time you want. You have to sign on some dotted line. Oh, yes, I've read all the books now. Can I join the church? No, there's nothing that, like that. Is there, pastors? Not that I've known. No, take all the time you need. Believe the Bible teaching on spiritual gifts. Take your time. Good and balanced counsel. Just taste the fruit. Check it out for yourself. So what do we do next? Here's what I say we do. Let's embrace, since we've got Kellogg's somewhere in our background, I say let us embrace the cornflakes commercial. Can you put that on the screen, please? Taste them again. Hallelujah. Taste them again for the first time. See, oh, come on, Dwight, what kind of a crazy marketing slogan is that? Well, don't you remember they were very successful with it. What kind of a crazy marketing slogan is that? How can you taste something again for the first time? Ah, but that's the whole point. You can't, but of course you must. Come back to what you grew up with, kids, grown up. Now, come back to what you ate as a girl, what you ate as a boy. Now, I grew up in Japan. We didn't have Kellogg's Corn Flakes in Japan. We had my mother's oatmeal, and we had granola made at the Japan Missionary College. That was the name at the time. So when we came back to the States on furlough, true story, my little brother Greg and my little sister Carrie, when we came back to the States and we stepped into an American supermarket and we saw that for breakfast cereals, the shelves are miles long. We thought we had died and gone to heaven. I mean, can you believe this selection? I mean, they even had something called sugar frosted flakes to die for. Of course, I've grown up now. I have a little more sophisticated palate now. Besides, Karen says I can't eat that stuff anyway. But that was the marketing ploy. Come on. You remember what you used to eat as a kid? Come on back to cornflakes. Taste them again for the first time. Pretend like you're a boy all over again. Pretend like you're a girl all over again. And take that bowl with that milk and the bananas on top. Taste them again for the first time. What would happen? Here's the point. Using that as our motto here, what would happen if we would do that with the writings of Ellen White? What would happen if we would taste them again for the first time? Guess what? I don't have to wonder what will happen because two brilliant friends of mine, Roger Dudley and Des Cummings Jr., you've probably heard of them, rigorous researchers, listen to what they did. They surveyed 8,200 Seventh-day Adventists in North America, 193 churches across this continent, and their research empirically has confirmed on a broad scale what many of us have experienced on a deeply personal level, namely, Well, you're going to see it. Namely, what their research did was they surveyed 20 spiritual disciplines, spiritual practices. And they asked you, do you do this, do you do this, do you do this? Yes, no, yes, no. One of the 20 was the question, do you read the writings of Ellen White? Then they pulled that question out, isolated it, and measured it against the responses in all the others. And you have it in your study guide, and that's why I want you to keep the study guide, because you have the empirical evidence. I'll put a few on the screen for you right now. We're going to skip the gift part 5. You already know that. Okay, strong relationship with Jesus. Would you describe your relationship with Jesus as strong or not? Those who read Ellen White, 85% of those who read Ellen White indicated, yes, by the grace of God, a strong relationship. Of those who do not read her, they check, no, I don't read her, 59%. Isn't that amazing? All this talk about the gospel. Apparently, the gospel affects how you respond to the gift. Apparently, the testimony of Jesus is wrapped up in that gift. Those who read have a strong relationship with him, 85% of them. Here's another one. How about your assurance of being right with God? Readers of Ellen White, 82%. I have that assurance, that gospel assurance in my heart. Non-readers, 59%. Isn't that amazing? How about this? Feel well prepared for witnessing. I think, Brother President, that was your concern. Can we leave from this place and feel like we have something to share? Elizabeth dealt with that this morning. Look at that. Those who read Ellen White, 49% feel well prepared. Those who don't, 24%. Daily personal Bible study. Isn't this fascinating? Some people say, no, I don't read her. I just only read the Bible. The people who don't read her, 47% have daily Bible study. The people who read her, 82% have daily Bible study. Isn't that amazing? Have daily family worship. You got kids still at home? Daily family worship. Of the readers, 70%. Of the non-readers, 42%. Leading Roger and Des Cummings to write. This is their conclusion. Seldom does a research study find the evidence so heavily weighted toward one conclusion. In the Church Growth Survey, on every single item that deals with personal attitudes or practices of spiritual life, the member who regularly studies Ellen White's books tends to rank higher than does the member who reads them only occasionally or never. Which being interpreted means, if you and I will taste them again for the first time, there will be a direct positive raising of the bar spiritually in our journey with Christ. Okay, so before I sit down, okay, Dwight, come on, 130 tiles, you can't be serious. I'm supposed to go through all these? No, what if we treated the testimony of Jesus, in this case, as being the testimony about Jesus? What if we took these three classics? You know this little classic? This is Steps to Christ. I was just noticing this today, I hadn't realized this, but this was bought here in the Oregon Conference ABC, gift from my dad, May 18, 1977. Bought it right here in Oregon, and it's been my little leather bound. This is the classic, the most translated, up to 130 languages. We're not quite sure how many. 130 languages, this little classic. I shared my testimony a few nights ago where I told you that it was reading. The professor sent me back and said, Dwight, you're in big trouble, read this. The title to this book became a self-fulfilling prophecy in my own life. I'm here tonight because of the ministry of Ellen White. I am absolutely unashamed and unabashed and unafraid to make that confession. Jesus, through his Spirit, worked through her writings. And I'm here tonight. Classic number one, Steps to Christ. It's waiting for you at the ABC in just a few moments. Classic number two, got it right here on the floor, and I'm going to pick down, just bend over and pick it up. I'm going to pick them both up here. I tell you, I'm really excited about this particular edition. And I'm excited about it because it reminds me of a dear friend of mine who sleeps in Jesus. His name, Jerry Potzer. And Jerry was a friend to all of us, I know. He's a personal friend of mine. It's because of Jerry that we have this little. And I'm excited that I want you to get this. And I went to the ABC early on this week, and I said, make sure you have these. You will sell these. This is Desire of Ages. Next to the Bible, hold it right there for you, red light camera. Next to the Bible, this is my favorite book. Just my favorite. You won't read a more stirring and inspiring recounting of the life of Jesus in this book right here. This is a paperback, and here's why I'm excited about it. Just keep the camera on this here, please. This is a paperback. Here's the genius. The old King James, I'm sorry to say this publicly, but it's very difficult to understand. Now, you're brighter than I am, and that's why you do well with it. But I have a hard time with the King James. I know Paul preached out of it, but I have a hard time with it. What Jerry did, and this is a gift to the church, what Jerry did, he says, listen, guys, we're not getting the young. I got 3,500 young adults in my congregation, 3,500 of them, on the campus, I should say. They're not going to pick up a book like this. They're just not going to pick up a book like this if it's not user-friendly. So Jerry went to Pacific Press and he said, hey, guys, come on, can you pull all the King James out, and can you replace it with New King James? In some cases, another translation that might make that text even sparkle a bit more. And so they've gone through and they've done that. It's still the same, the cornflakes that you grew up with, but maybe you want to come back and taste the cornflakes in a whole new package right here. And by the way, award-winning artist Daryl Tank, every chapter a pencil sketch to fit that moment in the life of Christ. Look at the cover, the cover photo, the cover sketch, and it's inside. The cover sketch is worth the whole book itself, and it's inside. Every morning you can begin your day, read it first in the Gospels, read that story, then find the matching passage right here and read it. I tell my college students, listen, 20 minutes a day, 20 minutes a day. Don't tell me you don't have 20 minutes at the beginning of your day. You have that time alone with Jesus. One story from the Gospels. You can add the Desire of Ages, one story, then read it in Desire of Ages. Make it come alive in your mind. And then write an email to Jesus reacting to what you just read. The writing of the email locks it in. Those of you who came forward tonight, this simple strategy, write an email to Jesus after 20 minutes brooding over the story from his life in the Gospels or Desire of Ages or both. Doesn't matter to me. But 20 minutes brooding over it, then you write an email reacting to it, makes the story stick in your mind all day long. I don't have his email address. You just put it into a little journal on your laptop. Do it on your telephone. Go to Walmart for 92 cents. You can get the 200-page line journal. I'm still old-fashioned and do it that way. But every day, write a letter to Jesus. Respond to his life. The testimony of Jesus will saturate your life. Three classics. Classic number one, Steps to Christ. Classic number two, Desire of Ages. And the third classic, hands down, the most dramatically influential book Ellen White ever wrote. Hands down. I know two theologians who came to Christ through the reading of this book, one chemist and two theologians, through the reading of this book. This is the history. This is the sweep of the Christian church. You read this book, you'll never be the same again. You will never be the same again. And it's the New King James. So you're looking for this cover, the New King James. Read it. In fact, may I share this with you before I sit down? Ellen White, speaking of great controversy. Notice how she puts this here. Put her words on the screen. The great controversy should be very widely circulated. It contains a story of the past, the present, and the future in its outline of the closing scenes of this earth's history. It bears a powerful testimony in behalf of the truth. I am more anxious to see a wide circulation for this book than for any others I have written. For in the great controversy, the last message of warning to the world is given more distinctly than in any of my other books. Three classics, the testimony of Jesus. They're all waiting for you just down the sidewalk. Go home and begin a new chapter, please. Go home and begin a new chapter, you and Jesus. Hush, hush the yapping of the critics. Trust Jesus himself. Take his testimony and wrap it into your heart. You will never be the same again. A little schoolboy comes racing out of his house. He's got his backpack on, panting as he arrives at the school bus stop just in time to see the taillights of the school bus disappear around the corner late again. And his neighbor is standing in the shadows. He sees the whole thing and he says, yo, Junior, looks like you didn't run fast enough. Oh, no, sir, he replied. I ran fast enough. I just didn't start soon enough. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not worried about the Seventh-day Adventist Church. You can run fast here in Oregon. I know you can run fast, but I am deeply concerned for this church that I love. I am concerned with the midnight cry sounding in my ear that we won't start soon enough, and we will not be ready. There's a world of 7 billion people to reach. God can do it literally overnight. Overnight. You say, he cannot. He can too. All God has to say is every guardian angel on this planet, Scripture is clear, every human being has one. Every guardian angel on this planet, now hear this. Materialize yourself to your human charge. Tell that charge she has 24 hours to make a decision. The world is about to end. And every guardian angel would appear. And overnight, the entire human race would make a decision. Don't you tell me that the last 5 minutes cannot come just like that. You've been stalling. You've been waiting. You've been thinking, I got all kinds of time. Only a fool would think that way. Jesus is coming soon. It's time to raise the bar. It's time to go for broke. It's time to be saturated with the gift, the testimony of Jesus.